Greetings again today in the name of Jesus Christ, our wonderful Lord and Savior. Good to see you here in the auditorium in the Northside Baptist Church today. We welcome every one of you. We appreciate your presence. We're glad to have some visitors with us today. And you in the radio listening audience, we most certainly appreciate you tuning in to the Northside Baptist Church Hour that's coming to you live right from the auditorium of the Northside Baptist Church here in Athens. Now, this is Preacher Edward speaking. We're hoping during the hour coming up we can be an inspiration to you. And you in the radio listening audience, if you get on your phone and call a friend, especially a shut-in one, and have them to tune in and get this hour coming up, we'll try to be a blessing to them. You have your Bible today for our text. Turn to 1 Samuel chapter 17. I'm going to continue on with the message today I started last Sunday. I'm speaking on the subject, "The Battle is the Lord's." I gave part one last Sunday, be part two today. The cassette tape last Sunday was tape number 180. The cassette tape today will be tape number 181, of course. And you get the music and the message on cassette tape, the entire morning program. We send these tape out for a gift of $3 each, and the gift is used to help defray our radio expense. I have many other cassette tape. I'll send you a list of them. I have about 178 listed. Just write in and request it. My mailing address is Virgil Edwards, P.O. Box 501, Athens, Georgia. 30603 is the zip code number. Now, if you're not getting our daily broadcast, if you'll be tuned to this station where you're now listening at 12 o'clock noon each day, Monday through Saturday, you can get the daily broadcast. I would like to say also, we now have our brochures on hand for our proposed Holy Land tour for next year. We plan this year to go to the land of Israel, many wonderful historical places there, such as Mount Calvary, the Garden Tomb, take a ride on the Sea of Galilee, we go to Masada, the Salt Sea, and places of that type. And when we leave there, we're going to Rome. This time, instead of Egypt, we'll be going to Rome. We'll be seeing the prison where Paul spent his last days, the Sistine Chapel, and the Vatican City, and many places in Rome that you've read about. That'll be our tour to the Holy Land of next year, and we'll send you a brochure at your request. Just say, "Preach Edward, send me a brochure on your proposed Holy Land tour." Now is the time to get your name on the list and start making plans for the trip. Remember, that mailing address is Virgil Edwards, P.O. Box 501, Athens, Georgia. 30603 is the zip code number. In 1 Samuel chapter 17 and verse 47, page 338. "And all this assembly shall know that the Lord saveth not with sword or with spear, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give you into our hands." I'm giving you another verse of scripture in Psalms 108 and verse 13. You don't have to turn there. I'll read it to you. "Through God we shall do valiantly, for he it is that shall tread down our enemies." There's never been a time when the devil's on the rampant like he is today. And the reason for that is he knows his time is short. He realizes it won't be long till his day will be over, and he'll be headed for the lake of fire. Now, the battle is the Lord's, and we told you last Sunday morning about the battle there between the Philistines and the Israelites, and how little David, of course, came on the scene, and how did he kill the giant? We'll tell you more about that today. But we saw many things about Goliath. We saw he was a type of the devil in many ways. We saw also he was a type of the Antichrist, because the number 6 is all over his name and the gear that he wore in his body. He was 6 cubits high. His spearhead weighed 600 shekels of iron. He had 6 toes and fingers on each foot and hand. He was marked all over with the number 6, and 666 is the mark of the beast, and so is the type of the devil. Little David is a type of Jesus in many ways. We find that he is number 8. David was son number 8, and there he's a type of the resurrection. And we saw on yesterday, or rather last Sunday, how that he was wanting to go to the battlefront, not that he desired to go, but his father commanded him to go to the battlefront there to carry food for his brethren, to check with the generals and to
See how things is going on the battlefront. And so little David rose up real early, verse 20. And I'm giving you scripture from the text where I read in chapter 1 Samuel 17. And verse 20, he leaves early in the morning. He shows his readiness to go. Leaves early in the morning. And then he comes to the battlefield in verse 20. He came to the trench. And he leaves his father's sheep in the hands of a faithful keeper. Verse 20. David was very conscientious and very faithful. And therefore he became a faithful king over the nation of Israel later on. God said, be faithful over a few things. I'll make you rule over many. And when he went to the battlefront, he was laden with blessings for his brethren. His father Jesse said, son, I want you to take some parched corn, take some cheese and loaves, and carry them to your brothers. He had two brothers in the army, there in Saul's army, facing the enemy, the Philistines. And so he carried some parched corn, some cheese and loaves to the battlefront for his brothers and also for the captains of the army. And you know, when Jesus came the first time, he said unto you first, God having raised up his son, sent him to bless you and turn away every one of you from his iniquity. When Jesus came the first time, he came with great blessings for the nation of Israel. And they rejected those blessings. The Bible said he came unto his own, and his own received a sad reception. He was not welcome when he went to the battlefront. Remember, it's the type of Christ, our greater David. And so was Jesus not welcome when he came to the earth the first time. In verse 28 of the chapter 17, said Eliab, his elder brother, heard when he spake unto the men, and Eliab's anger was kindled against David. And he said, why hast thou come down hither? And with whom hast thou left these few sheep in the wilderness? I know thy pride and the lowness of thine heart, for thou art come down that thou mightest see the battle. So his oldest brother accused him of coming down to see them fight, to see the battle. What battle? They were not fighting. They were scared half to death. They had met a stalemate there with the Philistine army. There was a great giant, Goliath, over on the Philistine side, roaming back and forth, cursing God's people, defying them to come forward, said, give me a man. Send me a man. If you have a man that can handle me, send him to me. If he can whip me, we'll surrender. If I whip him, you surrender. And they were afraid. Now Eliab was very angry and hated little David for this reason. When Samuel went down there to anoint a king from the household of Jesse, Jesse had 8 sons. He lined them up. And Eliab was the oldest son, and he should have been the one in line for the anointing. But whenever he lined them up before Samuel, Samuel looked him over and said, no, you're not the one. All the way down the line, he went through 7 sons of Jesse, looked him in the face, looked him over and said, no, the future king of Israel is not in this group. He said, Jesse, do you have any more children? He said, yes, sir. I have a little ruddy-faced boy out there watching the sheep. I didn't think you'd be interested in him. He said, you fetch him here. That word fetch means to get him here right now. I mean, quickly. Just don't have to wait around about it. I want him right here. And immediately they brought little David in. And when 1 Samuel looked at him, he said, this is the one. And he anointed the head of little David when he was only a lad to be the future king of Israel. David was a faithful keeper of his father's sheep. And when he went to the battlefront, he was ready to go. And he went carrying blessings, a type of Jesus, when he came the first time. Now, David's efforts were unappreciated. They didn't appreciate him coming to the battlefront. In fact, his brothers made light of him. They said, what are you coming down here for, little boy? Why did you leave those sheep, little boy? How about the lambs? Who's looking after them? They made fun of David. And David heard Goliath cursing over the way and cursing God and the army of God. He said, you mean to tell me that you people stand here, this great army of Israel? Well, stand here and let that man curse the army of God and blaspheme the name of our God. And they said, well, I don't feel like charging him. He said, I'll take him on. Now, Saul should have been the one that had taken on Goliath, his head and shoulder above the average man in height, but he was sitting back in the palace. And when he heard that little David was willing to take on Goliath, he was looking for a face saver, and he sent for him. And David went down to Saul's palace, and Saul said, you mean to tell me that you're willing to take on that big giant? He said, yes, sir. He said, all right, son, I want you to take my army in there and put it on and go down there and take him on if you think you can handle him.
David goes into the room, he puts on Saul's armor, he lifts the thing over, and looked to him just like the cooperative program of the Southern Baptist Convention, and he said, I don't want this thing, and he pulled it off, I don't need it. And so he said, all I need is faith in God and the sword that I have, I'll take care of him. He didn't need any degrees, he didn't need any course in the seminary, he needed faith in God and the sword of the slingshot, rather. He didn't need the sword, he needed faith in God, the word of God, which is the sword of God, that's all he needed. And Saul said, you mean you're going to take that giant on without a sword and without an armor? Yes, sir. I don't need the Baptist program. We can handle him all right with the word and the spirit of God, so let me go. And he took his slingshot and he went to the battlefront, and there he walked down toward Goliath. When Goliath saw him coming, he made all kind of fun of him. He said, boy, I'll feed you the buzzard. Said, don't you have more sense than to come down here and try to attack me, little old boy, you? What are you coming down here for? Now, David was a young, he was a late teenager at that time, and slim, young-looking feller. And so he said, why are you coming down here? Of course, David knew what he was coming for. He's going to take him on. On the way down, there's a little stream of water running between the two mountains. In fact, I have been there. I have a little stone in my house now I picked up out of that stream of water and kept it for a souvenir about the size I thought David used. Now David reached down in that brook and took out five stones. He put one stone in his slingshot and he put four in his pouch. Now you may say, Preacher Edwards, why did he pick up five stones, put one in the slingshot, one in the pouch? Well, old Goliath had four brothers over behind the hill. And just in case they got too big for their britches, he'd take them down a notch or two. But he only needed one to take care of Goliath. Now notice David's preparation to take on the giant. Now David has strong faith in God. In verse 47, he said, he will give you into my hands. He said to the giant, he will give you into my hands. He had faith enough in God to believe that. Now Saul's faithless crowd will always have an armor ready. They got to have the program. They can't get a message unless it's sent down from Nashville. They got to have the program to know what to preach. But David said, I don't need the program. All I need is faith in God and my slingshot and the help of God Almighty, and I can take him on. Now he goes down toward Goliath. And then before he does that, he said to King David that he had killed a lion and killed a bear. Brother Saul said, are you going down and take on Goliath? He said, yes, sir. God will give him into my hands. He said, I remember one time when I was watching my father's sheep, and out came a lion. And a lion in the Bible is a type of the devil. And out came a lion. He said, I just took him on and tore him apart. And there I saved my father's sheep and lambs. And he said, not only that, sir, but said one time a bear came out. And he was trying to get one of the sheep or the lambs. And I just walked over and took him on and done away with him too. He said, God gave me strength to do so. And he said, the same God that gave me victory over the lion and over that bear will give me victory over Goliath. Now he had unwavering faith in God. He looked to God for faith. He had unwavering faith in God. And so he said, I got the lion, the bear, I'll get Goliath. Now let me pass this on to you today. If you haven't gotten control of your lion and your bear, you better lay off Goliath. If you can't handle the little small things in your life, then, beloved, you better kind of go slow about the big ones. If you can't get rid of the little habits, the little things you have that you need to dispose of, don't take on any big jobs. You got to get rid of your lion and your bear first, and then you can take on Goliath. After you've handled your lion and your bear, then, of course, you can take on Goliath. Now David took the five stones from the brook. Now the brook in the Bible is symbolic. It's running water, symbolic of the Holy Spirit. He reaches down in the brook. He takes up five stones. Five in the Bible is a number of grace. All he needed to do is pick up five stones, a number of grace, out of the brook of running water, which is a type of the Holy Spirit. By the grace, power of God, of the Holy Spirit of God, and those stones, he could take care of Goliath. The Bible said that in the end time, there's stone coming from heaven cut out without hands to fill the earth. That stone is Christ. And so he took those stones from the running brook, which is symbolic of the Spirit of God and the Word of God.
Now he goes down for the battle. Now those Israelites over there beside that mountain, they saw that giant too big for them to hit. David looked at him. He said, that man's too big for me to miss, brother. I can take him on. And so he goes down to take him on. In verse 47, the battle is the Lord's. And when he goes down to meet the giant, four stones in his pouch, one in his slingshot, just one out of the five in his slingshot. He used only one stone. Now when Jesus, our greater David, came to this earth, and there he was driven into the wilderness and tempted the devil 40 days and 40 nights. The devil came, after he was hungry, the devil came and tempted him. And Jesus had four books at his disposal. He had the Pentateuch, the five books of Moses. Jesus could have quoted from all five of those books. He could use some out of all five, but Jesus took only one book, the book of Deuteronomy, and he quoted from the book of Deuteronomy, and the devil had to flee. Jesus didn't need the other four, just the book of Deuteronomy, just to quote out of that. David didn't need the other four stones, just the one that he had in his slingshot. Now the Bible tells us that David marched down, picked up the stone, walked over to challenge the giant. And then in verse 49, we see that he let the stone go and the stone hit the giant in the center of his head. There's only one bare place that he could hit him that he might have hurt him. And that was in the forehead. And whenever he let that stone go with such power, it hit that giant between the eyes and his heels went up and his head went down and he fell flat out there on the ground. Now there David stunned him with that stone. David did not kill the giant with that stone. When I was a little boy, I heard stories about David killing Goliath with a stone. He did not. He only stunned him. He only knocked him down, knocked him cold as a cucumber. And there he was laid out flat. Now when Jesus quoted from the book of Deuteronomy, he did not destroy the devil or defeat him completely. He only stunned him and put him in high gear and the devil took off. Now in verse 51, the Bible said, therefore, David ran and stood upon the Philistine, that is the giant, and took his own sword and slew him. So in verse 51 tells you there that David killed that giant with the giant's own sword. Not with a stone, his own sword. Now when time came for our greater David, the Lord Jesus Christ, to defeat the devil once and for all, he used the devil's own method, which is death. The Bible plainly tells you that in the scriptures. I'll give it to you in a moment. And I'll give it to you now. Hebrews chapter 2 and verse 14. That through death he might destroy him that had the power of death, that is the devil. Now, how did Jesus destroy and defeat the devil once and for all to become a usurper now and a defeated foe? Through death. That was the devil's own method, death. And Jesus took the devil's own method and through that method defeated him once and for all. Goliath takes the giant's big sword. He was knocked out cold. And he took that sword and he cut his head completely off, even with his shoulders, with the giant's own sword. He killed that big giant according to the Bible. Now the Bible says you can bind the strong man and you spoil his goods. That's exactly what Jesus did when he came and died on the cross. He bound the strong man and destroyed his goods. Now when David killed Goliath, then the army began to flee. The Philistine army turned their backs and they took off running. And the Israelites came running down that hill, chasing them and defeated them. Now, how and why did they defeat the Philistines? Because David, a type of Jesus Christ, had bound the strong man and now they were destroying his goods. The Lord Jesus Christ came the first time. On the cross, he bound the strong man. And through the power of God, he destroys his goods. That's why you can have victory today and sin shall not have dominion over you. That's why you can say the battle is the Lord's. He'll fight my battles. He'll help me. He'll guide me every step of the way and give me power and wisdom. He can do that. The battle is the Lord's. I don't care what you're faced with today, how strong the temptation may be, what kind of problem you may have as a Christian. The battle is the Lord's and he can help you overcome your Goliath as you sojourn. Not only did Goliath fall that day, but his sons fell later. Now later on, his sons were destroyed. We find the brother of David killed about four of them. And there they were destroyed, according to the Bible. Not only did Jesus defeat Satan on the cross, but he conquered principalities and powers, according to Galatians 2:15. Some people say, well, I can't live for God. Let me tell you something. Jesus Christ made it possible for you to live the victorious life on the cross. He took the devil's own method, which is death. He destroyed that power, and the devil cannot have dominion over you. He's a defeated foe. He can only tempt you and lead you astray. But God can give you power to overcome that temptation if you so desire. And so we find then that David killed the giant. Our greater David defeated the devil. And today the devil is a defeated foe. Now the devil knows his time is short. He knows at the end of this age he's going to the lake of fire. He knows that. He'll be put in the bottomless pit for 1,000 years and then be let out and sent to the lake of fire. The devil knows something about the future, and that's why he's working today as never before. I've never seen a time when there's so much temptation and sin and ungodliness as you find in the land today. I was listening to the news this morning. You listen to it every day on Sunday morning. You're going to hear about teenagers being killed, teenagers in car wrecks, teenagers out there smoking marijuana, on drugs, on liquor, on beer, wild as deer bucks, and getting killed every day in automobiles, many of them committing suicide. Reading the other day where three teenagers, young teenagers down here, I believe in Alabama, went into a store and shot the clerk in the back of the head and killed her. And she died, and they robbed her of $80 and went off down toward Florida and rented a motel room and went in there. One of them 14, the other two, I believe, about 17. And there the two 17 years old realized what they'd done and took a gun and was going to kill themselves. And the 14-year-old slipped out and told somebody what had happened and told them what he was about to do. And they called the law in and arrested them. And it shocked that whole community. They said never in that community had anything ever like that happened. It just shocked the community. They wouldn't talk, but they couldn't believe that that 14-year-old boy, and I believe the other two 17 years old each, would go out and kill a young woman. And she was working to take care of her child and was going to change jobs the next day. And there they killed her and left her bleeding and dying and took the money. That community could not believe those teenagers did that. You better believe the demons are out there, the devil's out there, and don't you be shocked at anything the teenagers do today. They see all of that junk on television. They see it. They smoke marijuana. They get on dope. They drink beer. They get with that wrong crowd. And don't you be surprised at what any teenager may do today. That's why your responsibility is so great. There's never been a time when you need to pray and watch after and care for your teenagers like in this hour. Every way they turn, the devil's waiting for them. Every way they turn to the wicked crowds out there. Every time they turn the TV on, they're enticed and encouraged to do things and see things on TV that leads them astray. Beloved, listen to me. You've never lived in a day like this. And they're in danger. And you better believe that. And only the safe place for them is in Christ. And you watch over them and guide them and encourage them and tell them that which is right and wrong and lead them in the right direction. Now the battle is the Lord's. In verse 52, and the men of Israel and of Judah arose and shouted and pursued the Philistines. When little David took care of Goliath, then they took off after the rest of the army. As David went down into the valley and engaged and defeated the enemy and came out with his head and carried it to Jerusalem, so did the Son of God go down into the valley of death, came up in the resurrection, showing complete victory over death, hell, and the grave. So Jesus came out victorious. He came out of that grave as a guarantee that one day our bodies must come out if we go to the grave before the rapture. In Hebrews chapter 2, verses 9, 14, and 15, but we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels, for the suffering of death and crowned with glory and honor, that he, by the grace of God, should taste death for every man. that through death he might destroy him that had the power of death, that is the devil. See, through death on the cross, the devil's own method, Jesus destroyed his power, destroyed him, and delivered them who through fear of death were in bondage. So you need not be afraid to die. Jesus Christ has already taken care of the sting of death. If you're a child of God, you need not be afraid to die. Death for you will be like a shadow. Death to you is just passing from one place into another. Death to you, the sting has been taken away. That's exactly what Jesus did on Calvary. He defeated the devil. He took away the sting of death. The devil held the human race in fear until Jesus defeated him on the cross, took away the sting of death. And God's people, when they move toward the end, all they have to do is look forward to going from an evil world into a heavenly world. The sting of death's all gone, nothing to fear whatsoever as far as death is concerned. The only thing you need to worry about is, am I doing my best for God? Am I doing anything for Jesus? Have I tried to get my loved ones saved? Are they on the road to heaven or on the road to hell? That's what you need to be concerned about. You need not fear death. Don't worry about death. Death is nothing for the child of God. It's already been handled. Jesus handled that on the cross, and when they buried him, he came out, and that was a guarantee that the grave will never hold your body. It may be there for a little while, but it'll come out. If you die before the rapture, that body will stay there in the rapture. It's coming out. When Jesus came out, it was a positive guarantee that you must come out. Mother Earth can't hold your body at the rapture. And the rapture is going to take place in the future. I heard, the most popular, well-known evangelist in the world make a foolish statement the other night on TV. Somebody asked him about the Battle of Armageddon. He said, yes, I believe in the Battle of Armageddon. Said it could happen next week. Not a word of that so. The Battle of Armageddon will not take place next week. The rapture must take place. The tribulation period must take place before the Battle of Armageddon. Not only that, he said it may be 1,000 years away. I don't believe that. Not only that, he said at the end of the Battle of Armageddon, the Lord's coming in the clouds and catch out his people. Not a word of that so. That man's all fouled up. He's run around with the liberals and the infidels and modernists and listened to that crowd and laid down with the dogs so long until he got up with fleas on him, and it's pathetic. And he's the world's leading most popular evangelist in the world. And now he's all fouled up in the scriptures. All he seemed to be concerned about is his large crowds and people making decisions. And most of them are not worth a dime with a hole in it. Just making decisions won't get you to heaven. You got to repent and believe on Jesus Christ, or you'll go to hell, as certain as I'm talking to you here this morning. If you're not ready to meet God, you need to repent and receive Jesus Christ as your Savior, because the point of the man wants to die. And after that, the judgment. I've looked in the face of dying men, dying without God. I've looked in the face of men that thought they were going to die without God and got saved, and God completely changed their countenance and gave them rest and peace. Rest and peace of soul can be yours ere you come to die. You don't have to be afraid of death. If you should leave the world today, it'd be a promotion for you. You'd be going to a better world, a world you need not fear about, because the only thing you need to fear is, what are you doing for God down here? That's your word. That's what you'd be concerned about. And that determines only your reward and not your eternal destiny. Now, this message today is the battle of the Lord number 2. Last Sunday was the battle of the Lord number 1. They're on cassette tape. They're available. You can write in and get them for $3 for each tape. We have other tape. And let me say this for the benefit of some of you in the radio listening audience. Recently, this last Sunday, I was reminded by one of my members that one of the tapes that this member had was kindly wavering or seemed like slipping. And I checked my duplicator. I got Brother John Bruce, a boy that's a master of many trades. And he checked it and found some grease on the spindle and took the grease off, and everything is fine. And the recorder is fine. And so if you out in the radio listening audience and you have a tape, and that tape's a little wavery, seem to be slipping a little bit, if you'll send it back to me, I'll redo that tape and send it to you where you can listen to it without any problem if you desire. It may not be too bad that you want to do that, or you get the tape to me. Either let me know and I'll send you another tape. I'll be glad to replace it. If your tape is a little bit wavery, and that's happened recently on my tape, I've been sending out, and I didn't know about it until my attention was called to it. Now you've listened well here today. God bless you. Stand to your feet. Everybody be much in prayer. And while you're standing to your feet, we're going to have a word of prayer. Dear Father in heaven, I pray now that you'll use the message, that you speak to many hearts. Lord, we thank thee. The battle is the Lord's, and we have the victory, and we need to shout all the way in because we do have it. And give thy people victory. May they not worry about death or facing death. They don't need to worry about that, Father. May they be concerned about doing things for thee while they're yet alive. I pray in Christ's name. Amen. Now listen, Debbie's going to play for us on the organ. If you're here this morning and not saved, you ought to come down here and give your heart to Jesus. Let God save you, repent of your sins, believe on Christ. If you're here and backslidden on God, if you'll come, we'll help you back to the Lord. If you're here and you want to join this church the way we receive members, you may come forward. Or for any other reason that God is speaking to you about, and you need to come to this altar, while Debbie plays a couple of stanzas, will you come? We're waiting. Speaking, you obey the Lord. I brought the message God laid on my heart. That's all I can do. It's entirely up to you to respond to the invitation. Understands her, we'll be going.